Chapter 66. The underestimation of Warble by his political opponents is that they compare their chance to defeating him in a debate to that of a snowball in Dallas. Much to their chagrin, they come to conclude that a snowball has a much, 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 much better chance of surviving in Dallas than they do of prevailing in the debate with gab-gifted Warble. Warble's tenacity in the debate makes a bulldog look like a newborn lamb. The intensity in Warble's eyes as the showdown begins makes a professional wrestler's stage persona seem like Art Linkletter. The ferocity and viciousness of Warble's attacks make those from a cobra or shark seem like a love bite to comparison shoppers. Warble's first unfair advantage, most people would consider it unfair anyway, Warble just considers it good planning and the prerogative of those who have the wisdom to think of it and the means to pay for it, is having Jean-Jacques Flambeau in the audience during the debate. Jean-Jacques is big and intimidating and has a commanding, resounding voice. Warble's people have seen to it that Jean-Jacques is seated near the front of the stage. The function of the French-Canadian fur trapper and lumberjack is to heckle when Warble is not talking, and to loudly agree with everything when Warble is at the lectern. When Warble makes a point, Jean-Jacques says, "Yeah! You said it, brother!" Or, "You tell him, Warble, baby!" When his opponents have the floor, Jean-Jacques boos, hisses, and makes all manner of rude noises. At periodic intervals, whenever Warble's opponents make a point or stop for a breath, Jean-Jacques yells out, "Yeah? Who says?" Or, "Your mama wears combat boots." Or, "Fooey on you, buster." Naturally, the tactic works like gangbusters. Warble's opponents are rattled. And then there's the hum. The sound men are in on it too, and whenever Warble speaks, they turn up the reverb and the bass. When Warble's opponents speak, they twist the knobs in the opposite direction, cranking the treble all the way up, causing feedback and the aforementioned unnerving hum. Not satisfied with having the sound crew in his figurative pocket, Warble has also bribed the cameraman. When the camera is on Warble, the photographer slips a rose-colored filter over the lens. When the camera is on one of Warble's opponents, off comes the rose-colored filter, and in its place, an olive drab green lens is attached. Warble's first opponent gives his speech. Blah, blah, blah. Warble's second opponent takes the podium. Yada, yada, yada. Warble finally gets the spotlight and rips right into his opponents, with all hands on deck and no holds barred. First, he goes after the incumbent. "Mr. President, why haven't you satisfied the American people? Just look around. Walk down any street in America and observe the people. You can tell by the look on their shoulders that they are not content. What have you done, Mr. President, to make them happy? Politics is human husbandry, and that doesn't mean you are supposed to or allowed to act as if you are the husband of all the women in the country. Husbandry means protection. Have you protected them, Mr. President?" The incumbent stands up and opens his mouth to address the implied charge leveled against him and attempt to answer the question. "Sit down, Mr. President," Warble yells, pointing at the beleaguered man. "I paid for the cameraman and the sound crew, as well as the most erudite and influential members of the audience. I paid, I'll talk. I graciously gave you your chance. Now, getting back to your deplorable behavior in office, your sins of omission and commission, I have one suggestion for you. Go find a mirror, then look in it, and slap the first person that shows up." The president stands up again to protest. His Secret Service agents appear discomfited. They don't know whether they should protect the current, outgoing president, or whether they should play it safe and hopefully preserve their jobs by supporting the incoming chief by doing nothing. The sitting president, now standing, is red, flushed, and shaking with fury. "This is an outrage! I won't stand for this!" "Then sit down, Mr. President," Warble interjects, pointing to the president's folding chair. "I'm not finished. Let me explain to everyone, just to make it crystal clear, how you've betrayed the people's trust. Power to the people, right on! Jean-Jacques yells. While you were being chauffeured around Washington and traveling the globe in style, dining at the swankiest restaurants, staying in the poshest hotels, there I was, poor little old everyman Warble P. McGorkle, deserted on a maroon island. While you ate yourself fat and drank yourself silly, I was fighting off 37 of the Viet Cong, all by myself, barehanded. The president stands up again and challenges Warble's claim. I've caught you in a bald-faced lie, McGorkle. You're not old enough to have been in Nam. Who said anything about Vietnam, Mr. President? The event to which I am referring took place while I was applying for a job at a Walmart in Walla Walla, Washington. Jobs were so scarce after you ruined the economy that I had to bite, scratch, and gouge just to get a measly minimum wage job. Publicly disgraced and humiliated, the incumbent sinks back into his chair and, putting his head in his hands, begins to weep inconsolably. Seeing he's got them on the run, Warble dives back into the pack, this time going for the jugular of his other opponent. The outcome is not much prettier in this case. Warble's opposite number had, in a vain attempt at eloquence, quoted Plato and Socrates, as well as Wolfman Jack, in his earlier speech. Plato? Socrates? Warble says incredulously. I think you've got soccer and golf mixed up in your addled mind, Senator. It's golf that uses tees, not soccer. Or is that a British tradition at soccer games? At any rate, not even the great Chinese philosopher Confucian or the equally great and inimitable East Indian philosopher Gondola would dare quote the great American philosopher Wolfman Jack while at the same time holding a personal fortune consisting entirely of South African Krugerrands. Senator, if I may say so, you are an imbecile. The senator doesn't know what to say. He didn't expect such a virulent and personal attack. He hopes to get out of this debate without losing any hair, teeth, or any more of his dignity. Losing his composure, the senator stammers, stutters, and finally, inexplicably, blurts out, "That's beside the point." Warble hesitates, letting his opponent's faux pas sink in. The aggressor smiles wanly, drums his finger lightly on the podium, and shakes his head as if in pity of the poor, imbecilic statesman. Yes, Senator, it is beside the point. It's right beside it. The American public will not suffer fools, nor will they tolerate imbeciles. Begone with you. Egged on by Jean-Jacques, the crowd begins chanting, Warble! 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 After letting the easily amused crowd work themselves into a frenzy, Warble waves his hand to silence them. No hysteria, please. I thank you for your support. I count on it in the upcoming election. As the great philosopher Goofy, in his guise as Super Goof, once said, I always knew I was somebody special. This specialness of mine is at your service. I will be your president. Yes, folks, I'm here to stick my neck out, lay it on the line, and go out on a limb. I guarantee to all of y'all from Louisiana that I will win the election. Realizing that Warble has just delivered the coup d'etat and the soundbite, Jean-Jacques sneaks around the perimeter of the stage until he is at the back steps which lead up to the podium. Grabbing a 10-gallon container of Gatorade, and slipping up behind Warble undetected, the big galoot pours the entire contents on Warble's head in a celebratory gesture. The fur trapper, slash lumberjack, slash heckler, then picks Warble up bodily and, lifting the drenched candidate high in the air over his head, carries him triumphantly away from the noisy mass of humanity. Warble continues waving to the crowd until he disappears from sight. The debate, as planned, is a resounding success for Warble. The crowd, unwilling to be restrained from their irrational exuberance and spontaneous show of support, renew their mantra, Warble! Warble! Warble!